I was here indeed the first time, but the question is whether I will ever be invited by you again, because today it's really going to get ugly. I'm going to get deep into immunology, and I'm not an immunologist, so I'm going to tell you a lot of things that are not true. No, just kidding. Let's start with this next slide, if it works. It doesn't work? Yeah. Okay, it's very slow. Okay, we all know that, and it was a surprise to many, even clinicians, that obesity actually comes down when you have a SARS-CoV-2 infection with very severe disease. And around that obesity, why was it surprising? Because we knew that long before, we knew that from influenza viruses, that it comes down very severe in people who are overweight. And we also knew it from the first infection of the corona, SARS, and also from MERS. So I was surprised that they were surprised, but you see here that obesity is in the middle, but around that you see all kinds of factors that actually are related to obesity, and actually it is the same, because what you're talking about, and that's the common denominator, it is low-grade inflammation. You can also call it the metabolic syndrome, you can name it metaflammation, flammaging, whatever you call it, it is all the same. And we also know that it's not very fast, this detector. Yeah, okay. We also know now that long COVID, which is also called PASC at this moment, that also diabetes and body mass index are very important risk factors. The same holds true for hospitalization. And that is, of course, logical, because most of these people who have overweight or obese actually have been hospitalized. So it comes down to the same risks that we acknowledge for COVID itself. Okay, this is what I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell you about a too little, too late interferon response. For that, I have to explain to you what interferons do in our body. And I'll tell you and show you that SARS-CoV-2 is a very, very clever machine. It hijacks both the interferons in response, and actually it destroys most of our immune system. Very clever, of course, if you destroy the one that's going to destroy you. That's how evolution works. I'll show you the central part, and that is leptin and insulin resistance. We have heard a lot about insulin resistance this morning already. I'll show you something about cytokine signaling and what leptin and insulin do in the immune activation, and so on. Show you very shortly something about therapy. Why? Because I was surprised that doctors were waiting for a randomized controlled trial. And actually, I'll show you something else that surprised me. And then, and that will be the main part, something about supportive care, micronutrients, because there's no attention to that paid at all. And then I come to a conclusion. Okay, let's have a look what is the natural history when you contract severe COVID. In general, the incubation time is 5 days, and when you really get sick, at that moment you have the maximum peak load of virus. Very interesting that you didn't get sick earlier, and that has to do with what the virus does. You see that after 2 days, counting from the moment you get sick, you have the seroconversion. Okay, you start making IgM, first antibody. Then it takes 7 days, if you are bound to get severe COVID, to get hospitalized. And after 8 days, you really get shortage of breath and the problem really begins. And the interesting part is that after 9 days, there's no study showing that there is actually any viable virus in your body. And then the whole thing starts, because then at the same moment you start with acute respiratory distress syndrome that becomes more problematic, causes you to be admitted to the intensive care. And you see that the same time that you really get sick, the IgG starts to pop up. Okay, so it sounds as if it cannot be the virus when you really get sick, and it sounds as if it is your immune system. And it took many people a lot of time in order to understand that it's not a virus that is killing you, but actually it is your own immune system that's killing you. Okay, and then you are treated in the ICU, and it takes you normally 17 days in the ICU, just counting from here. And people will die, let's say, average 17 days after they are admitted to the ICU. And you can afterwards, if you survive, contract PASC, as I said. And at this moment, the definition is that you need to have symptoms. And there's a whole list of symptoms at this moment. It's not a very clever definition as yet. That takes you, after 4 weeks, if you still have those symptoms, then you have long COVID. Where do I have to find it? Okay. Now the question is, how come that you are not so sick at the moment that you are really contracting the virus? It is multiplying like crazy. And how come that you feel so well? Okay. I guess I have to stand here. That's better. Now the reason is that in a normal reaction, you will contract the virus, it will grow, but you will immediately come out with an interferon response. And what that does, I'll show you. But the problem with people who have a delayed interferon response, and those are people who especially have low-grade inflammation, I'll refer to that as such, then you see that the virus can multiply indefinitely, I could say. And you see that the interferon response is too late. And for that reason, the virus can multiply like crazy, and you will have to start with an enormous immune reaction in order to get rid of all those viruses. And that will lead to an overreaction. The overreaction is shown as follows. You can see that normally you will respond with antibodies and with T-cells. T-cells very important. But these people who are bound to get a very serious disease, they have much more antibodies and they have a very low T-cell response. Now the main question is, why is this happening? Because understanding what's happening there is actually the key. So it is the too late interferon response, and that causes the disbalance in the immune system that I just described. Well, it ends up with a so-called cytokine storm. You must have read that at least in the papers, because everybody was talking about that. And that has to do with the fact that the virus comes into the cells, and it can be a lot of different cells, whatever cell that carries the ACE2 enzyme will actually be able to contract the virus, and you see that all these cells start signaling, and it is in an uncoordinated way that they will start signaling. Everybody is screaming to each other, do something, and that ends up to a lot of problems, especially organ damage. So you end up with multiple organ damage. For instance, your kidneys will stop functioning, so you need dialysis, etc., etc., and it is becoming worse and worse. Now, what also surprised me from the beginning, because I was looking, although not a pathologist, at the autopsy, what does it look like? And what is clear from the beginning is that when they looked at the organs of people who died, that they could hardly find any virus. What they saw is massive inflammatory reaction, and they immediately understood that it had to do with the immune system and not with the virus itself. Let me just show you some data. from two very important organs in these. Of course, the lungs, they are a mess, meaning that you will find coagulation, you will find hemorrhage, and the heart. And the heart is becoming more and more, especially in long COVID, it's becoming a major issue. I'm not a cardiologist, fortunately Remco can correct me, here you see a thickening of the right ventricle. And if you see such a thing, you always think immediately about diastolic heart failure, as I still call it. But this is a pressure overload. That means that the heart has to pump with enormous power in order to try to perfuse the lungs. So this is also a problem that we that we see in long COVID. And if you look at the peripheral organs or in the lungs, you see coagulation. Many people were very surprised, coagulation, who's possible. We know for very long that if you have a massive inflammatory reaction, you're going to coagulate. And so they could have been treating those patients much earlier with the right treatment. And you see it very nice, I'm a clinical chemist, you see it very nicely in the laboratory, because you see the D-dimer increase, meaning that there must be massive coagulation. You see that the lymphocytes are down, so you expect the patients to be unable to react to in a normal immunological reaction. You see the IL-6 very high, meaning there is a lot of inflammation ongoing. Here you see the ferritin, which is a positive acute phase protein. And you see the troponin, which is a marker for heart failure, for heart damage. You see it increase, and this is a general marker for heart damage. So we could have known it from the beginning. That's my point. Summarizing, what you see is a suboptimal immune response, hyperinflammation, you see microvascular dysfunction, and you see thrombosis. Okay, let's have a look more into detail what the mechanism is. For that, I have to do some steps back and explain to you that there are five groups of cytokines, and I'm going to talk only about the last one, the cytokines that signal via the Jak-STAT pathway. And very important for you to know is that we, at this moment, we make a distinction between cytokines and hormones. Forget about it. One hormone has much more different functions than just one. If you talk about insulin, what does insulin? Well, it does something with your glucose and your lipid and your protein metabolism. It also reacts on your kidney. It sees about the reabsorption of sodium in your kidney. So if you want to understand salt sensitivity, you have to know something about insulin. Okay, but that's not the point. I'll show you that EPO is also a cytokine. Thrombopoietin, which causes the megakaryocyte to produce platelets, is also a cytokine. And here you see leptin, and I'm going to talk a lot about leptin. Growth hormone is also a cytokine. So here you see that metabolism on the one hand and inflammation are actually the same. It is only dependent on the receptor that you will hit on what cell in order to bring about the kind of reaction. Okay, here you see the complete list of all the different cytokines. You're not going to read it, of course. But important ones are leptin, which is a member of the IL-6 family, and that sounds very pro-inflammatory. And important are also the IF-1 and the IF-2 and 3, especially the 1 and 3. This one is inflammatory, and this one sees to it that viruses do not multiply that easy in your cells. Now, what do? They confer antiviral protection on target cells. That's what the interferons do, 1 and 3. They are critical components of the innate immune response, and they cause the transition to effective adaptive immunity. So if you go from the the innate immune system to the adaptive. You need a trigger coming from interferons. Let me show you more in detail in a cartoon. Here is a virus that comes in, doesn't matter what kind of virus, and it is detected, and the signal is transduced to the nucleus, and in the nucleus you will produce first interferons, interferon 1 and 3. What they do is they will be secreted and land on another cell. And what that cell at that moment is experiencing is that it has to protect itself against viruses. There are viruses in the body, we are going to protect ourselves. And how does it do it? Several ways. First of all, it shuts down RNA synthesis. And you know that it is an RNA virus, meaning that you will shut down the possibility to multiply. It signals to infected cells that they should go into apoptosis, meaning that the virus that is in the cell will be destroyed, and it activates immune cells. So very important. You can imagine that from an evolutionary point of view, it is very rewarding to target this system. And that's what very many do. Here you see the interferon stimulated genes that all come to expression, lots of them, just by being triggered by the interferons. And you can see apoptosis, immune modulation, cell attraction and adhesion, and antiviral and pathogen detection. Once again, very rewarding to tackle this system by a villain. Now, we do not like to fight, because if you are going to have an inflammatory reaction, there's going to be a lot of damage, you're going to spend a lot of energy, so we rather defend, okay? And attack you can always do in a later phase when you cannot defend anymore. What is the tactic of the virus? The virus will actually attack our defense system, and that's what it does. And in that sense, SARS-CoV-2 is no exception at all. And let me just show you two of the main mechanisms by which it disturbs our immune system. Here you see the virus, you all know the spikes, you see the RNA, which contains the genetic material, it's the genetic code. It contains codes for no more than 29 proteins. We all know, of course, the structural proteins, like the spike protein. You have all probably been immunized with that spike protein. But besides the different spike proteins, the structural proteins that you see here, we are two other classes, which are the accessory proteins and the non-structural proteins. These are very small proteins that disrupt the immune system, and they are not unique to SARS-CoV-2. There are many viruses that do that. Now, it's a little bit detailed, but here you see this virus again coming in, and it tries to start an interferon reaction, and you see that all those proteins coming from the virus will interfere with this signaling, whether it is going to the nucleus of the infected cell or whether it goes into the cell that is signaled by the interferon. And it does that very effectively. It does it even more effective than SARS and MERS, which are the predecessors of this virus. Now, here you see a whole list, and it's not a complete list, of all the viruses that do exactly the same. And they also target the system that I'm going to show to you in just a couple of minutes, and that's the so-called SOX system. Just remember it. I'll come back to that later. Okay, what is the influence of leptin and insulin? To understand what is happening, I have to go back and try to explain to you how a cytokine signals. If a cytokine comes in, it will be triggering a receptor. There will be some phosphorylations going on, I'm not going into detail, and it ends up with a transcription factor, meaning that's the protein, in this case it is a dimer, and that dimer will land in the nucleus. Here you see it again, we have about 50 cytokines, We have many different of these kinds of proteins as well. Finally, you end up with this dimer, and this dimer will end on your DNA, and in your DNA comes to expression all the genes that I just explained to you. A very important one is SOX. And SOX is a protein that will inhibit the whole system. So you see a very nice negative feedback system in which the signal will finally be inhibited by a protein that during the expression will also come to expression. So a very important system. So you limit your own immune response by producing your own inhibitor. That's what's happening. Now what happens in obesity is that, and that you know that very well, that when your BMI increases, also your leptin increases. Your adipose tissue will be infiltrated with macrophages and it becomes inflammatory tissue. And it will secrete at large amounts of fat, not only leptin, but a lot of different pro-inflammatory factors that brings you in a situation of low-grade inflammation. So far, so good. This is what you already know. What you also know is that this low-grade inflammation of this expanded fat tissue will eventually destroy many of your organs, whether or not you are diabetic. It even happens if your glucose is not above 7 mol per liter. Now, in the chronic system, low-grade inflammation system, we have a big problem because their SOX is already induced, meaning that these people have a limited ability to respond in their immune system. So they're already inhibited the moment that they are contracted. They contract the virus. And the virus, on top of that, will also inhibit SOX. You understand that 1 + 1 becomes 3, and that that it really becomes a problem in order to get rid of it. So there are crucial roles of leptin and insulin. And let me go back, because you all know what leptin does. We are talking about appetite-stimulating and appetite-inhibiting hormones. This one you know, leptin, it is appetite-inhibiting. There are many of those, and that's very nice in textbooks. And you know, of course, that leptin being produced by the adipose tissue will signal to the brain, stop eating. That's what it actually says, stop eating. We have sufficient adipose tissue. But the problem here is that leptin is not only a signal for appetite. It also has to do with growth, with energy expenditure. Well, that's the one that I just go, and also with reproduction. And the general idea here is that it allows a cell to pick up glucose. I come back to that later. It also has an immune function. And in the immune function, we are talking about immune activation, the proliferation of cells, and the maturation, which is actually the heart of the immune response. So very high in the immune response, leptin comes in and has to do its job. Here you see a normal immune response. There is, let's say, a virus that is detected by the cell. And what this cell does is starts multiplying like crazy. And all those different cells will have their own function during maturation so that they can do their job in the immune reaction. But the question, the million-dollar question, is really, what happens here? What is the first trigger that starts this whole event? And for that, you have to know that the first thing that has to happen is that the cell will need energy. And in order to get the energy, especially in the immune system, you need glucose, because the immune system is working on glucose, and it is working on an amino acid, a glutamine. Those are the most important ones. Okay, so you have a cell, this quiescent cell that is triggered, and the first thing that it does is that it is going to pick up glucose in order to multiply and to maturate. And finally, if it fades away, it will go back to a memory cell in this case and wait until it is triggered again. This is the main event where leptin comes in. And very important is that this cell is going to be reprogrammed. This cell is actually reprogrammed to the Warburg metabolism. And for those of you who are not familiar with that, Otto Warburg, who got a Nobel Prize for his finding, showed that actually happens during cancer. And during cancer, exactly the same happens, because Warburg is not only connected to cancer, it is in general connected to the multiplication of cells, so to the dividing of cells, so metabolic problem. We're going to hear much more about Warburg in the future. You better try to keep that word in mind. So it means the first thing that you have to do is to induce a transporter so you can pick up the glucose, and that is GLUT1. And leptin is the one that induces GLUT1. So if you have leptin but it is not working, you're not going to start an immune reaction. I hope that you see the connection, okay? And if you have the problem with leptin resistance, then of course you are not going to start with that. So by mediating GLUT expression, leptin grants activated T cells permission to take up glucose and initiate an energy-consuming immune response. I hope you understand you are at the absolute top of the starting of an immune reaction, and the leptin in somebody who has low-grade inflammation actually prevents the whole immune system to be activated. Okay, very, very important, I would say. Now, we know that if you have very low leptin, for instance, you have no adipose tissue like many of the children in Africa, then, of course, you don't get emission for energy expenditure, meaning that if you get infected, your immune system is not going to react. On the other hand, if you have elevated leptin, leptin doesn't work because you're leptin resistant, and meaning that you also your immune system is not going to react when you contract a virus or whatever. Now, a second thing, and we have been hearing a lot about insulin, insulin and leptin go hand in hand. Because if leptin goes up and you get some kind of leptin resistance, you also become insulin resistant. And the reason is that they are connected. And talking about measuring insulin in these cases, you see that when you get fatter, that your insulin, of course, goes up because you are insulin resistant and you're going to get hyperinsulinemia. But look what leptin does, much more. And the current view is that leptin resistance is above insulin resistance, okay? So, and at least they come hand in hand, let me put it that way. And the main mechanism is against SOX. They can mutually interact. So if you bombard the insulin receptor with insulin, you're going to get SOX. It's going to shut the insulin resistance receptor down, but it also shuts down the leptin receptor, and vice versa. If you come in here, it goes that way as well. So they come hand in hand, and I think we should not make any distinction between leptin resistant and insulin resistance anymore. Now, obesity is a pro-inflammatory immune response. Let me just summarize what I just said. So we have adipose tissue dysfunctioning because it is much too big. It starts in an inflammatory reaction. Leptin is a cytokine. The cytokine brings you to chronic inflammation. You see that there starts to be leptin resistance and also insulin resistance. You get a problem with your immune system and you are susceptible to virus infections. So what the immunologist is very interesting to see that everybody talks about a T cell and the one talks, well, it doesn't react. The other said, well, maybe it is a little bit old or something like that. It's all the same. We are talking about a vanishing T cell. The T cell response is not happening. Okay, what is the role of leptin and glucose in severe COVID? Well, if you look at the most predictive compound or factor in this case, it is leptin. This is a ROC curve for those who can read it, and you can see that the ROC curve is even better than TNF-alpha. So leptin, high leptin, is very predictive for serious COVID. But also hyperglycemia is important. And we know that because near half of the patients with COVID-19, they have abnormal glucose metabolism. How does that work? This is the basis. If you have diabetes, you see that the percent survival is lower compared with non-diabetes. If your glucose is high, you have less chance of surviving. If you have diabetes and you have high glucose, not well established, then you see that you have less survival. But even more surprising, if you are not a diabetic and you have high glucose, you're not going to survive very good as well. Now, how it works, we'll not go into detail, but this is an enzymatic reaction in which this enzyme is going to add glucose to this factor. And this factor here is a cytokine promoter. So that means if you have high glucose, you're going to produce more cytokines. That's what it is said. And we also know from very old studies already that high glucose gives an inflammatory reaction. So glucose is very inflammatory, especially if you have high glucose. Now let's talk a little bit about therapy. Well, first of all, pharmacotherapy. We have a lot of drugs at this moment. We have antivirals, we have the anti-inflammatory, and we have the so-called comprehensive support, nutritional support I'm going to talk about, and just show you something about steroids. I cannot talk about them all. When you talk about the inflammatory reaction that's ongoing, you have to. It's very important that you break it up in phases, because in the first, let's say, 11 days up to 9, you will have the viral replication. So that's the moment that you want to treat with antivirals, because after 9 days there's no virus present. You can come in with antivirals, but only if you have a secondary virus infection. Later on, it is the immune system that will kill you. And at that moment, you have to treat with corticosteroids or any anti-inflammatory. And the pulmonologist until then had a so-called protocol that tells you not to use steroids. Why? Because you will actually help the virus. And that's true. You're not going to treat such a patient in a very early stage when the virus is still replicating, because then you need your immune system. But later on, if there is no virus and your immune system is killing you, you better use the corticosteroids, as was shown finally by this trial. And from that moment on, everybody was treating with corticosteroids as if it was something completely new. We already knew it for a very long time. I'll tell you something about supportive care and notably the micronutrients, because there's not much attention being paid to that. Well, the only real protection against future COVID-19 or whatever pandemic will be that you have a healthy immune system, because that's the real, culprit. If you have a compromised immune system, you're going to contract a very serious reaction, and no matter what. So very easy, this is the most simple, and you could have thought about it yourself on a Wednesday afternoon. If you have a good nutrient supply, you have a good nutrient status, you have a good immune function, and you have a good defense against pathogens. Very simple. Any child could understand. But then you have a poor nutrient supply, you have a poor nutrient status, you have a poor immune function, you're going to contract all kinds of infections, and they're going to be very serious. It is as if this, logical thing doesn't happen in medicine, because they need randomized controlled trials, and those are not done. That's quite clear. You see that most of these, and there's only four that I show you here, zinc, omega-3, so EPA and DHA, and vitamin D and magnesium, they all suppress the inflammatory factors that will bring about the cytokine storm. So if you do not have sufficient of those micronutrients, your immune system cannot even react because it doesn't live only from glucose. It needs the micronutrients in order to metabolize as well. Now here is zinc. Zinc, very important. Many people, probably less people here in the audience than out there, will be zinc deficient, and especially the elderly. I'll show you some data. And zinc will inhibit almost all reactions that have to do with the multiplication of the virus. But you need to treat it in the viral phase. If you come in late, you can do a randomized controlled trial and find out that it is not working. So the phase at which you are doing this is very important. So some of the people talk about exhausted T cells. Well, leptin and insulin resistant cells are indeed, they look exhausted. They can do nothing, so they look exhausted. But if they have insufficient micronutrients, they look exhausted as well, because you need them in order to do your metabolism as is needed. So we know, especially, that obesity is a malnutrition state. Of course, these people, they eat too much and they exercise too little. That's macronutrients. But if you look at the micronutrients, it's a mess. And we know that for a very, very long time. Why do older people have poor nutritional status? Well, many reasons. Poverty, many of old people, especially, let's say, in the more developing countries, but also, for instance, in the United States, they have poverty, they cannot buy proper food, impaired appetite, senses, taste and smell, there's effects of medication, and they have all kinds of comorbidity that prevents them for having a good micronutrient status. Let me just show you some data, because there are millions of these kind of slides that I can show to you. If you look at obesity or type 2 diabetes, you see a lot of deficiencies that these people actually have. That's partly because of the medication. Metformin, for instance, is very well known for lowering your B12 status, just to mention one. But if you provide somebody with a diuretic, he's going to lose a lot of minerals. And if you do not provide sufficient minerals, they will eventually be deficient. If you look at for instance, older adults, I can also show you millions of slides showing that they're selenium deficient, zinc deficient, iodine, and copper deficient. We do know that zinc has a very peculiar reaction in which you see that with age, it first increases and then it decreases. When those people were infected in northern of Italy, I immediately searched for the element status of those people in Italy, and I came out with this slide where you see that with age in the north of Italy, the people have lower zinc status and they're even selenium deficient, especially at older age. And we do nothing about it. I'm going to go far faster through these. If you have an infection and you contract some kind of virus, then you're going to change your metabolism, that's for sure. And one of those is that there will be a nutrient decrease. You will see in the plasma a decrease of many micronutrients. So a viral infection also brings about a lot of oxidative stress. So some of the micronutrients you're going to need more because you're going to use them more. Here you see what happens with vitamin C in a critical ill patient. It drops immediately while the CRP goes up. You see the vitamin C drop. Here you see what happens with alpha-tocopherol, ascorbic acid, so vitamin C, and reduced glutathione. In this case, it is mice suffering from influenza. So there's enormous oxidative stress. You're going to need more of these in order to keep on the level. And this is also a very nice picture where you see that selenium in the people who eventually died actually went down, whereas those people who survived actually stayed on the level and even increased. So it is very important that we know, and we do not know much about it, what happens in those in that period, because you're not going to supplement like crazy, because also your iron will go down, for instance, and you better don't give iron, because if you have a bacterial infection, you will make it even worse. But some of them you can probably very well give. Now, there is prevention and there's treatment. So you can treat, actually prevent, try to prevent serious infection. Here you see a randomized controlled trial with vitamin E. Here you see a randomized controlled with zinc in elderly, all preventing infection. And this is treatment. This is treatment of people with zinc. And you see that a meta-analysis of treatment with zinc is positive, and it is not being done. So the idea is that if you start with a very good status and you are contracting some virus, then you will, of course, need more, so it goes down, but you recover. But if you are marginal, you will get into the danger zone and you might even die because of shortage in fighting. And remember that RDAs are not based on surviving in surviving infection. It is actually mostly based on other targets that are not important with respect to infection. So I come to the conclusions. It is all about Darwin. Darwin said that we have to adapt to the conditions of existence, and we now know how we do that. Darwin didn't know about genetics. But we know that we do that by mutation, selection, epigenetic, and by sensors. The new definition, not widely accepted yet, is that the ability to adapt and to self-manage from Machtelt Hubert was shown this morning already. This person is very poorly adapted. And officially, this person is not sick. He has got a metabolic syndrome. He has a lot of risk factors, but he is not sick. This is the person that is actually going, when he's going to get sick, whether he gets a myocardial infarction or whether he has a brain accident or whatever, he is going to have the more serious disease. We know that very well. So all the diseases that are related to the metabolic syndrome, actually, we already knew, but let's now also put risk of poor outcome of infection also at that moment. So nutrition is prevention. Yeah, only upon a trigger, infection, myocardial infarction, brain trauma, whatever, deficiency become apparent, the body cannot respond, there is no resilience. Thank you.